In today's class, we'll discuss about the 8051 pin diagram. As you can see that 8051 is a 40 pin dual in package IC. There are 40 pins are there from pin number 1 to pin number 40. And also we need to visualize what we have discussed during our initial classes regarding the architecture of 8051. As we know that 8051 has got everything on chip, from RAM to ROM to IO ports to the interrupt, everything is on chip. So we can see that there are four ports in 8051, four IO ports: port 0, port 1, port 2, and then port 3. You can see the these four ports in the 8051 IC also. So you can see that this is port 0. There are total 8 pins are there: port 0.0 to port 0.7. This is with respect to port 0, and then 8 pins from pin number 1 to pin number 8 of port 1. So you can see a port 1.0 to port 1.7. So port 0 and then port 2, port 1 and then port 2, pin number 21 to pin number 28, P2.0 to P2.7. So total 8 pins are there with respect to port 2. And then finally coming to port 3, pin number 17, from 10 to 17. So you can see that port 3.0 to port 3.7. So total we have 4 IO ports. So those 4 ports are shown on the IC also. Apart from these 4 ports, we also have the interrupts. There are 2 interrupts are there: interrupt 0 and then interrupt 1. You can see that pin number 12 and pin number 13 are used for interrupt 0 and then interrupt 1 respectively. You can also see that the same pin 12 and then the 13 are used for 2 functions. One is for port 3 and as well as for the interrupts. And you can see there are 2 pins, that is pin number 10 and pin number 11 are also again used for 2 functions, along with port 3. It is also used for reception and then the transmission. And then you can see that pin number 14 and pin number 15, along with the port 3 function, they are also used for 2 timers, timer 0 and then timer 1. As we studied that there are 2 timers in 8051 which are on chip. And then pin number 16 and pin number 17 are used for write and read, along with the function of the port 3. And then you can see pin number 18 and pin number 19 are used for XTAL1 and XTAL2. These are used for connecting the crystal frequency to 8051. And then pin number 20 is used for ground. Pin number 40 is used for VCC. You can see here pin number 39. That is from 32 to 39, along with port 0, the same pins are also used for AD0 to AD7. Here A indicates address and D indicates data. As we have discussed the meaning and the use of address and the data buses, so here the total 8, that is AD0 to AD7, all these 8 pins are used in a multiplexed format for both address as well as for the data. Then we have one more pin, 31 pin is used for EA. This is external access. We'll discuss this external access in detail. And then we have one pin for ALE, that is address latch enable. Then one pin for PSEN. This PSEN stands for program storage enable. And then you can see that pin number 21 to pin number 28, along with port 2, we are also using for A8 to A15. Here A stands for the address. So in totality, you can see from pin number 21 to pin number 40, we are using a total 8 lines of data lines, that is D0 to D7, and then 16 address lines, that is A0 to A7, and then from A8 to A15. That means the 8051 has got 8-bit data line and then 16-bit address lines. So if you are looking at the detail of each functions, so VCC, that is pin number 40, basically this pin number 40 to which we are connecting plus 5-volt voltage source that is required for the operation of 8051 IC. And then pin number 20 is used for ground. So every electronic circuit, as we know that, we need to use a power supply and then we need to connect one pin for the ground. And then two important pins, that is pin number 18 and pin number 19, are used for on-chip oscillator. As we know that, if you remember the block diagram of 8051, the oscillator is also there on-chip. But along with that, we also need the external clock to run it. So in most of the cases, the XTAL1 and XTAL2, to this we will be connecting an oscillator which generates the frequency, desired frequency. Then we have one more pin, that is pin number 9. This is used for reset. RST stands for reset. So it is the reset pin, which basically an input and active high. Upon applying a high pulse to this pin, the 8051, what it will do, it will reset and terminate all the activities. After this reset pin, the 8051 will be having all the default values. In the previous class, we are discussing about some of the default values, as when a microcontroller is up, then we have discussed that the default stack pointer value will be 07, the default register bank will be 1, and then so on. So once we apply a active high voltage on the pin number 9, it is in a reset mode. Then we have one more important pin, that is EA, which basically stands for external access. And as we know that this external access is basically required for either enabling or disabling the external memory interfacing. As we are discussing, basic objective of designing 8051 microcontroller is for a few of the applications where memory requirement is less, we require a low amount of memory. In that case, microcontrollers are preferred. But there are some applications wherein the on-chip ROM and on-chip RAM is not sufficient. So in such scenario, we need to interface the external memory to 8051. So in that scenario, this EA pin plays a very important role. So we need to use this. We'll be discussing the major function of this A in detail in the subsequent slides. The 8051 family members all come with on-chip ROM to store the programs. But still, in some cases, we need to interface the external memory, either RAM or ROM, to it. And then we have one more important pin, that is known as what, PSEN. This is an output pin, and PSEN stands for Program Store or Code Enabled. In case of 8031 system, the external ROM holds the program code. So this pin is connected to the output enable pin of ROM. If not 8031, if you want to interface some external memory to 8051, so in that scenario, in that case, PSEN is always connected to the OE pin of ROM, that is output enable. Again, we'll discuss the functionality, detailed functionality of PSEN in the subsequent slides when we discuss the numericals on this. And then we have one more important pin, that is known as what, ALE, which stands for address latch enable. Again, it is an output pin which is active high. Again, ALE pin is used for demultiplexing the address and data by connecting to the ground pin of the system. As you can see that, if you are looking at the pin diagram of 8051, from pin number 32 to pin number 39, here AD0 to AD7, that means both address and data lines are used in a multiplexed format. But for accessing the data from the memory location, we need to look at the address, the total address, that is from A0 to A15. So in that scenario, we need to demultiplex that. So for that purpose, we need to use ALE. Again, ALE, PSEN, and EA, we will discuss further in detail in the subsequent slides. Then coming to the ports, as we already know that there are four ports in 8051, that is port 0, port 1, port 2, and then port 3. And we also know the pins of all these ports. So initially we'll discuss about port 0. As we have seen in the pin diagram of 8051, port 0 has got 8 pins, similarly port 1, port 2 and then port 3. That means all the 4 ports has got 8 pins. So port 0 occupies pin number 32 to 39. This port can be either used as an input port or can be used as an output. That means a port 0 can be used as an both input as well as output. And if you want to use the pins of port 0 as both input or output, each pin must be connected to externally to a pull-up register. So this is the case only in port 0. Port 1, port 2 and port 3 doesn't require to be connected to a pull-up register externally, because in port 1, port 2 and port 3, this pull-up register is there internally. Coming to port 1, port 1 again occupies 8 pins from pin number 1 to pin number 8. Again, the port 1 can also be used as an either input or output. And you can see the changes here, right? In case of port 0, port 0 basically requires a pull-up register which needs to be connected externally, whereas in case of port 1, no pull-up register is required because it is already there internally. Port 1 can be configured as an output upon reset, and to make the port 1 as an input, it must be programmed as such by writing 1 to all its bits. So total there are 8 bits are there. So if you want to use port 1 as an input, then we need to transmit the bit 1 on all the 8 points, P1.0 to P1.7. Now coming to port 2, again port 2 has got 8 pins from 21 to 28. Again it is same as that of port 1, and it differs from port 0. This port 2 can also be used either as an input or an output. Just like port 1, again port 2 doesn't require any pull-up register because again it is connected internally. We need to keep in mind that in port 0 we need to connect a pull-up register externally. So in port 2 can be configured as an output upon reset. Again you can see the similarity. Port 1 can also be configured as an output upon a reset. Similarly, port 2 can also be configured as an output upon reset, and again you can see the similarity. To make it input, it must be programmed as such by writing 1 on all 8 bits. So port 1 and port 2 almost same. The functionality of both these ports are same. Now coming to one more port, that is port 3. Again it occupies 8 pins, pin number 10 to pin number 17. These 8 pins either can be used for input or it can be used for output. Again, port 3 doesn't require any pull-up register, same as port 1 and port 2. Port 3 has an additional functions. If you are looking at the pin diagram of 8051, you can see that the pin number 10 to pin number 17 are basically used for port 3, and along with the functionality of port 3, it is also doing some additional tasks also. You can see that 2 pins are used for RxD and TxD, 2 pins are used for INT 0 and INT 1, and 2 pins are used for timer 0 and timer 1, and then 2 pins are used for write and read. So along with the function of port 3, port 3 pins are also doing some additional functions. So you can see that port 3.0 and port 3.1 are used for RxD and TxD in serial communication. Again, in the subsequent modules, we will be discussing serial communication in detail, and in those modules further we'll discuss about port 3 in detail. And port 3.2 and port 3.3 are set aside for external inputs, as we have discussed in the initial classes of this 8051 microcontroller. The 8051 has got on-chip interrupts also. So there are two interrupts which are there, that is INT 0 and then INT 1, and then port 3.1 to P3.5 are used for the two timers, again which are there on chip, timer 0 and timer 1. There are two timers, and further each timer can be operated in different modes, mode 0, mode 1, mode 2 and mode 3. Again, these timers and then the counters and then the serial communication will be discussing in the module, further modules. And then two more pins, that is P3.6 to 3.7, are basically used for write and read signal for the external memory connected to 8051. So in basically there are important pins. All the pins are important, but from the perspective of if you want to interface external memory to 8051, then we need to be clear about external access pin, programs store enabled pin, then address latch enable, and then we also need to use the read and write pins of port 3, that is 3.6 and then 3.7. Along with these, for the interfacing we also require the two ports, either port 0, port 1, port 2 or port 3. We'll discuss how to interface the external memory to 8051 in the next slides. So if you are looking at the block diagram, basically what we are doing here is we want to interface the RAM and ROM, which is external to the 8051 microcontroller. As again and again we are discussing that the 8051 microcontroller has got on-chip RAM and on-chip ROM. Now here question comes, what is the necessity of using a RAM and ROM which is external to 8051? Because what we said or what we discussed in the beginning of this course is 8051 has got the RAM and ROM which is on chip, and if you compare the microcontroller to the microprocessor wherein the memory is outside the chip, and in the advantage of microcontroller over microprocessor we said that as memory is there on chip, microcontroller is preferred over microprocessor. Then here again what we are doing is we are trying to interface the external memory to 8051. So basically everyone will be having a doubt that then what is the necessity of interfacing a external memory to 8051. So to answer to this question is there are various flavors of 8051 which comes with a different amount of RAM and ROM, on chip RAM and then on chip ROM. Obviously the 8051 or the flavors of 8051 has got some X or Y amount of RAM and ROM which is there on chip. But when we try to write a program, the programs can be written either in a machine language or we can use a assembly language program, or we can use a high level language. When we use the assembly language program, the amount of memory required will be less. Moment we, if you want to write a program in high level language, then the amount of memory required will be more. Obviously, even if the microcontroller has got a memory on chip, sometimes we need some additional memory. So in that scenario, we need to interface RAM and ROM to 8051. Again, the amount of RAM and amount of ROM that can be interfaced to 8051 depends on the user. But there definitely exists a maximum amount of RAM and maximum amount of ROM that can be interfaced. It is not like that you can interface any amount of RAM and any amount of ROM to 8051. So we'll discuss the maximum cutoff limit of RAM and ROM that can be interfaced to 8051. Before getting into detail, let us look at the block diagram. If you are looking at the 8051 microcontroller along with 40 pins, right? We are basically few pins and few ports are shown here. So we are using a port 0 and we are using a port 2. It is not mandatory that we need to use only port 0 or port 2. We can use any port for that factor here. And we are using ALE pin, that is address latch enable. We are using a program store enable pin. And along with that we are using read and write. So these pins are used at the 8051 microcontroller side, and then on the right hand side we have a RAM and then we have a ROM. Here we have mentioned about 64 kilobyte of RAM and 64 kilobyte of ROM. As I said earlier, this is not standard, right? It depends on how much amount of RAM and how much amount of ROM we want to interface. And then we have a latch also. Now look at the connection of port 0. Now port 0, as you can see from the pin diagram of 8051, this port 0 has got 8 pins, that is AD0 to AD7. So meaning of AD, as we have discussed, is both address and data lines are used in a multiplexed format. So the total 8 lines are used for address as well as for the data in a multiplexed format. But if you want to use RAM and if you want to use ROM, then these address and data lines needs to be demultiplexed. So you can see that we are using a latch here, and you can see that the AD0 to AD7, now it is demultiplexed. You can see that here we are getting only D0 to D7, that is data lines, and the output of this latch will be the only lines. So then we port 2, we are using port 2, we are using A8 to A15. As we have discussed that 8051 has got 8 bits of data and 16 bits of address. So A0 to A7 will be getting here, lower 8 bits, and then the higher 8 bits will be getting from port 2, that is A8 to A15. So if you are looking at the RAM, this arrow mark and this arrow mark combinedly will give us the 16 bits of address. And then the read and write of 8051 is connected. Write is connected to write of RAM, whereas read is connected to the OE pin of RAM. OE here stands for output enable. And then again, sometimes we may also require to interface ROM also. So in that case, again, you can see that this D0 to D7 is connected to ROM, and then address is also connected to A0 to A7, and A8 to A15 is also connected here. So you can see the block diagram of this, which basically tells us how to interface the external memory. That external memory may be RAM or may be ROM to the 8051. So in this way, the external memory can be interfaced. Now basically look at the some important points of interfacing of external memory to 8051. So the 8051 microcontroller has got 4 kilobyte of ROM and 128 byte of RAM, which is there on chip. This is known to us. And latest 8051 microcontrollers have got 8 kilobyte of ROM and then 256 bytes of RAM. Again, comparing to 4 kilobyte and 128 byte, here we have 8 kilobyte and 256 bytes of RAM. But in some cases, again, we may require, for example, instead of 8, we may require 16 kilobyte or 32 or 64 kilobyte of ROM, right? So in that scenario, we may need to interface it. Then the designer of 8051 microcontroller based system is not limited to the internal RAM and ROM which is present on the on chip. That means always there is a provision of connecting external RAM and ROM to 8051. Of course, it has got some amount of RAM and some amount of ROM on chip, but also there is a provision, if you want, you can connect the external RAM and ROM to it. And the reason for connecting, as we have discussed, that if somebody is writing a complex program, or if they are writing a program in a high level language, then the amount of memory required will be more. So in such scenario, for example, in 8051 we have a 128 byte of RAM and 4 kilobytes of ROM, read only memory. So that 4 kilobyte of ROM may not be sufficient for some applications where there are complex programs which needs to be written. So in that scenario, along with 4 kilobytes, we may need additional 4 kilobytes or additional 8 kilobytes. In such scenario, we need to interface the external memory to 8051. So that can be done. Then another important reason for interfacing is that the chips like 8031 or 8032, which doesn't have any internal ROM. So in that case, we have to have interface the external ROM to it. So there are basically two reasons. One is 8031 or 8032, which doesn't have internal ROM. So we have to have interface external ROM to it. Even though the 8051 and the advanced version of 8051 has got ROM, either 4 kilobyte or 8 kilobyte, but it may be required more amount of ROM for writing a complex program. So in that scenario, the external memory has to be interfaced. Then coming to how much amount of memory, either ROM or RAM, that can be interfaced to 8051 externally. So the maximum limit is 64 kilobyte of ROM and 64 kilobyte of RAM that can be connected to 8051 microcontroller. Again, you may be having doubt that why this maximum limit, why 64 kilobyte, why not more than 64 kilobyte? Why? So you need to think over it. We'll discuss why maximum 64 kilobyte is only possible to interface to 8051. Then external ROM is accessed whenever external access pin is connected to ground or whenever PC contains an address higher than the last address of internal 4 kilobyte of ROM. So in both the cases, the external ROM is accessed. One case is what, EA pin is connected to ground, or we are generating an address which is more than the last address of internal 4K ROM. The operation of interfacing of external RAM to 8051 can be explained with this diagram. You can see that we are using two ports, port 0 and port 2. Further, we know that port 0 basically is used in a multiplexed format for both address lines as well as data lines, that is AD0 to AD7. And then we also know that port 2 is used for having the information about the remaining 8 bits of address lines, that is A8 to A15. So you can see that total 15 address lines, that is from A0 to A15, and then D0 to D7, that is 8 lines of data. And then along with this, during the discussion of pin diagram of 8051, we have discussed the importance of address latch enable, then program store enable. So you can see that this address latch enable is transiting from low to high for generating the latch address. For external memory addressing, we need to use the program store enable pulse. So this program state enable pulse is whenever it becomes low, then it enables the ROM, external ROM. So once it is low, PSN is low, during this period we can read the whatever information we want to read from ROM, which is external to the 8051. And then RAM, as RAM stands for random access memory, so in that case both read and write is possible. So whenever read pulse goes low, so this basically enables us for reading, and whenever write pulse goes low, it enables us for writing. So you can see the excess of ROM and excess of RAM, which is connected external to the 8051. So that can be done using ALE and then using PSEN and then the read and write. So basically what we have discussed up to now is a pin diagram of 8051 we have discussed. There are total 40 pins. Those 40 pin consist of 4 ports, port 0, port 1, port 2, port 3. Along with that, there is a 1 pin for VCC, 1 pin for ground, then address latch enable, program store enabler, then we have further pins like XTAL1, XTAL2, then external access, then address latch enable, and then the program store enable pins are there. So we have discussed the function of each pins of 8051 in detail, and also we have discussed how to interface external ROM and external RAM to 8051, and what is the necessity of using the important pins of 8051, that is address latch enable, then program state as program store enabler. And also we have discussed basic reason for interfacing the external memory to 8051 and the maximum amount of memory that can be interfaced also we have discussed. And also we have discussed the functioning or accessing of external ROM and external RAM using this diagram. This already we have discussed, so I will not be getting into detail of that. Then one more important parameter we need to discuss in 8051 is the special function registers. So some of the registers we have already discussed. There is a register, 8-bit register by name accumulator ACC, and there is a one more 8-bit register known as what B register. Then we also discussed a 16-bit register known as what DPTR. Further, this DPTR can be divided into two parts, DPH and then DPL, both 8-bit. Then IE is interrupt enable controller. As we know that interrupts play a very important role in microcontroller as well as in microprocessor. Basic objective of interrupt is what? Whenever an external device wants to utilize the resources of either microcontroller or microprocessor, a signal will be generated on interrupt controller. There are two types of interrupts, hardware interrupts and then the software interrupts. Again, there is a concept of what if you have a more than one number of interrupts, then comes the term known as what priority. For example, if you have the two interrupts, say INT0 and INT1, and if the interrupt is coming on both the pins simultaneously at the same time, then microcontroller will be in a dilemma to which interrupt it has to give the service, whether to INT0 or INT1. So in such scenario, there is a concept known as what priority. So there is a lowest priority interrupt, there are higher priority interrupts. So whenever a request is coming on more than one interrupt lines, then microcontroller basically looks at the priority and then accordingly it will give the service. So next pin is, you can see that there is an interrupt priority as already we have discussed. So this interrupt priority basically tells the microcontroller to which interrupt it has to give the service first. Then there are four ports are there, port 0, port 1, port 2, port 3. So these are the latches. Then we have one special function register known as what PCON, which basically stands for power control register. So as we always know that in case of mobiles or in case of computers, we have a facility of what sleep mode or idle mode. So whenever a microcontroller is not in use, then using these P control registers, we can kept in idle mode. Then PSW we have discussed in detail, which is program status word. It has got four conditional flags, carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then parity and overflow flag. Then two bits are used for selecting a bank and two bits are not used. Then we have one more 8-bit register known as what SCON, which is basically used for serial port control. Again, we will be discussing this SCON and serial port data buffer in detail in the subsequent modules. Stack pointer we have discussed in detail. Again, it is a 8-bit register. And then there is one more 8-bit register known as what TMOD. Either there are timers and then the counters. So whether to use a timer or we want to use a counter or whether we want to use different modes, mode 0, mode 1, mode 2 and mode 3. So this 8-bit register is basically used for selecting the operation of either timer or counter, also for the mode also. And then there is a one more 8-bit register known as what TCON. This is for timer or counter control. And then four registers, special function registers, TL0, TH0, TL1 and then TH1. These are used for the timers. As we know that there are two timers on chip in 8051, timer 0 and timer 1. So timer 0 has got the two registers, TL0 and TH0, and timer 1 has got TL1 and TH1. Again, please keep in mind that in a module, fourth module, we'll be discussing these timers and then the counters in detail. Now, let us look at an example wherein we want to interface an external memory to 8051, both ROM as well as RAM. Again, as we have discussed that the amount of memory that can be interfaced depends on the user. Some may want to interface 8 kilobyte of ROM and 8 kilobyte of RAM, or 16 kilobytes of ROM, 32 kilobytes of RAM. It depends on user. So if you're looking at the example, right? So here we need to design a microcontroller system using 8051, wherein we need to interface 16 kilobytes of ROM and 32 kilobytes of RAM. Now, along with this, there is a starting address of both ROM and RAM is given. So interface the memory such that the starting address of ROM is 000H. And then the starting address of RAM is 8000H. So the important input in this example is what? One is 64 kilobytes of ROM we need to interface. Second one is 32 kilobytes of RAM we need to interface. And along with these 16 kilobytes of ROM and 32 kilobytes of RAM, also mentioned is the starting address of ROM and then the RAM. So we know that there are 16 address lines are there, A0 to A15. So the solution for this problem is, first let us look at the ROM. If you're looking at the problem, what he is saying is he wants to interface the 16 kilobyte of ROM. So given is what? Memory size of ROM is 16 kilobyte. So we have the equation 2 to the power of n is equal to 16, where this n indicates the number of address lines. So for what value of n, we'll get 16k is for n is equal to 14, we'll get 16. So the address lines we need to use are 14 address lines. So basically we have 16 address lines A0 to A15, 16 address lines are there. And for interfacing 16 kilobytes of ROM, we need to use 14 address lines, that is from A0 to A13. In the interfacing problem, I asked the question of what? The maximum amount of 64 kilobyte of ROM and 64 kilobyte of RAM can be interfaced. I asked the question that what is the reason of this maximum, why not more than 64 kilobyte? So answer to this question, you'll get from the number of address lines what we have in 8051. So the total number of address lines we have is 16, that is A0 to A15. So 2 to the power of 16 will give us what? 64 kilobyte. So it is not possible to interface more than 64 kilobyte of memory, either RAM or ROM to 8051. So that we need to keep in mind. So from the given amount of ROM, that is 16 kilobyte of ROM, we need n is equal to 14. Then question comes is what we need to do for two remaining address lines, that is A14 and then A15, and then program store enable. So this A14, A15 and then PSEN, both these pins are odd and it is given to chip select block. We'll see in the next slide. Okay, so when all these three, that is A14, A15 and then PSEN is low, then ROM is selected. Then So that for that reason we need A14 is equal to 0, A15 is equal to 0, and then PSEN is equal to 0, because we are using a OR gate, and we know the function of OR gate is what? When all the inputs are 0, then only the output of OR gate is 0. So if you want to use ROM, then A14, A15 and PSEN has to be given as an input to OR gate, and the output of OR gate is given to chip select, and we need to make them as 0. Now coming to the second important information in the problem is about the RAM. So here what we are saying is we want to interface 32 kilobytes of RAM. Again we need to use the equation 2 to the power of n is equal to, instead of 16 now we need to keep 32. So for what value of n we will get 32 is what? For n is equal to 15 we will get 32k. So for this case we need to use 15 address lines, that is from A0 to A14. So A15 we need to give it to the NOT gate, and which is given to chip select. So when high, RAM is selected, when low, ROM is selected, and when high, RAM is selected. So we need to keep in mind this A15 also for selecting the RAM. So if you are looking at the this slide and whatever we have discussed, depending on amount of ROM and depending on amount of RAM that can be interfaced, we have found out how many number of address lines are required. For 16 kilobyte we require 14 address lines, and for 32 kilobyte we require 15 address lines. And when we use 14 address lines, the remaining 2 address lines along with PSEN is given to OR gate, and if you want to select ROM, then these 3 should be 0. And for 32 kilobyte of RAM we require 15 address lines, that is from A0 to A14, and then A15 is inverted, and then RAM is selected along with this, right? So what we have done is we have selected the number of address lines for both ROM and then the RAM. Then next important aspect is the starting address of ROM is 000H, and from 000H we need to use the addresses up to 16 kilobytes. So we should calculate the last address. This is the first address of ROM, and then if you are using 16 kilobyte of ROM, then what will be the last address? And then the starting address of RAM is 8000, and totally 32 kilobytes of RAM is there. So we should be able to calculate the last address of RAM also. So that is shown in the next slide. So PSEN is used as chip select pin for ROM. RD is used as read control. WR is used as a write control for the RAM selection. Again, keep in mind that read and write are only used for RAM, because RAM stands for random access memory. That means for both read and write, whereas ROM stands for read only memory. So here this RD and WR are not required. Now look at the addresses. So what we have written is here, we have written the address lines, all the 16 address lines, A0 to A15, and in the problem itself the starting address of ROM is given as 0000. You can see that the starting address of ROM is 0. So those all zeros are represented in binary. So 0000000, so all zeros. And then the amount of ROM that we are interfacing is 16 kilobyte. So we have calculated that totally we require 14 address lines, that is A0 to A13. So A0 to A13 we have made is equal to 1, and A14 and A15 we have made is equal to 0 along with PSEN. So PSEN, A15 and A14 are 0, and these 3 are given to OR gate, and output of OR gate is given to chip select. So then ROM is selected. So you convert this into its hexadecimal equivalent. 0011 is 3, 1111 is F, 1111 is F, 1111 is F. So the starting address of ROM is 0000H, and the last address of 16 kilobyte of ROM is 3FFF. Similarly, we need to find out the last address and address of RAM also. The starting address of RAM is given as 8000. So the 8000 is represented in binary. So 8 is 1000 for 0, all zeros. And then the end result, as we calculated for the RAM, 32 kilobyte of RAM, we require 15 address lines. So A0 to A14, and A15 needs to be high for RAM selection. So A0 to A14 is 1 because we need 15 address lines, and then A15 also we have made is equal to 1 because we now we are talking about RAM. Whereas in case of ROM, A14 and A15 we have made is equal to 0 because for selecting ROM we need these bits to be 0. So the starting address of RAM is 8000, whereas end result is FFFF, and same is represented in a block diagram. So there is a 8051 pin. You can see that there is a 16 kilobyte of ROM and 32 kilobyte of RAM. So P 0.02 0.07, that is 80 to 87, is connected, and using latch it is demultiplexed. So you can see D7 to D0, and lower 8 bits of address, that is A0 to A7. Then we are using address latch enable, and then port 2.0 to port 2.5, A8 to A13 is connected to RAM because only we need 14 address lines. Then 2.6 and 2.7, that is A14 and then A15, along with PSEN is given to OR gate, and output is given to chip select for selecting the ROM. And you can see that the same is given to read, because ROM stands for read only memory. So here we are only reading the data. Whereas coming to 32 kilobyte of RAM, so same connection is given to RAM, D7 to D0, A7 to A0, and then A8 to A13. And then we know that A14 and A15 is also connected, and A14 and A15 to be 1. So for selecting 32 kilobyte of RAM, we need 15 address lines. So A0 to A14 is used, and A15 is 1 because now we are talking about RAM. And then 3.6 and 3.7, these are read and write, is connected to read and write of RAM. So you can see that in a program wherein we want to interface external memory, RAM and ROM, that can be done. So this is a very important problem. In most of the cases, this problem will be asked only. He will change the values of ROM and RAM, and he may change the starting address of ROM and RAM. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.